And what happened there? You were the champ of Bellator, and then all of a sudden you left, and everybody was like, "So you're still undefeated, right?"
I'm undefeated, 18-0.
So what the fuck happened that Bellator let the champion go?
That wasn't what happened. So
no.
And there's so much misinformation out there, and you know, I'm popular, but I'm not that popular, and so lots of times my story gets mistold because I get spoken over by other people, right? And they don't hear what I say. So here's what happened. Obviously, so prior to me in Bellator, Hector and Eddie were the ones that left, right? They were, Hector
Lombard and
Eddie Alvarez
were the UFC, both of them.
Both the middleweight champ and then the lightweight champ, and they both got taken care of pretty well. But if you remember Eddie's situation, I don't know if you remember this, he got an offer from the UFC, still under the matching period with Bellator. Bellator says we matched it, right? And in terms of what was in the contract, it was matched, right? But because Bellator has no pay-per-view venue, well, if UFC says we'll pay you on pay-per-view, Bellator says, well, we will too. But that's not real life, right?
Right.
That's fictitious.
They've done 2 pay-per-view shows ever.
And they've never met any type of threshold. So, you know, they say it matches, but it doesn't say, I don't know if you remember, but they went to court over it. And the UFC won. Eddie got the right to. I'm sorry, he didn't win. He somehow did like a one more fight in Bellator and then went to the UFC. I don't know exactly what the finality of that case was. But anyways, when that happened, his contract became public knowledge, right? And so a lot of UFC fighters were pissed because they gave him a whole bunch of money. And so when I was 12-0, I had my last fight in Bellator against Andrei Kreshkov, July 30th, maybe 31st of 2013, beat him up pretty good. And then I had a 12-month matching period. And so what was expressed to me by the UFC brass was that you need to get rid of your matching clause. And we will make you an offer, but we will not make you an offer until that happens.
Get rid of your matching clause.
Yes.
How do you do that?
Well, here's how I went about doing it. Because it's 12 months, right? That's a freaking, I'm not going to sell for 12 months.
Right.
So I'd call Bjorn every 3 days and say, hey, Bjorn, I'm not going to resign. Please
Bjorn
let me.
Bjorn is the guy who was running Bellator.
Correct,
the time.
Yeah. And now he got fired.
Yeah.
But, and Bjorn had a terrible reputation, but I had a decent relationship with him. I never like butted heads too bad. So every day they said, Bjorn, let me go. I'm not coming back. And then so everyone says, well, Bellator didn't want to re-sign me. Well, that's not true at all. Every day it's Bjorn, let me go. Bjorn, let me go. Because, you know, I love challenges. What I love more than anything in the world is to challenge myself. If you look at my wrestling career, that's what it's all about. Taking the next best thing every single time. And so, yeah, so finally and all this time, you know, Dana in the UFC is saying, we want Ben Askren. I'm ranked number 7 in the world or what, you know, somewhere around there, 12-0. And so I remember I was going to the Asian food store because I was going to make some tonkatsu soup. And Bjorn calls me and said, you're released. Full, you're released. You can go. And I say, I appreciate that. So Friday morning, it was Thursday night, Friday morning, it's in November sometime, maybe mid-November. Morning, they fax over the release. My management faxes it to UFC headquarters, and all of a sudden that afternoon, there's a you know like a little scrum where everyone's asking Dana questions, and then Dana says, "We're not interested in Ben Askren," and I said, "Wait, what just happened there?" Right, because for the last 3 months they were saying we were interested. Now I finally produced this full release from Bellator that I got, and now they're not interested, and so I said, "Wow, I just got caught in the middle of this." And
so was there a reason given?
Well, so then I say F that. I bought a plane ticket to Vegas for Monday. So that was Friday that happens. I say fuck that. I'm going to Vegas. Right. I'm not taking this shit, you know? Right. So Monday I buy my plane ticket to Vegas. I fly out to Vegas to UFC headquarters. I met with Lorenzo. Dana was on the little speakerphone dealie, and they offered me a Zuffa contract, but it would be confidential, and I would have to fight one fight for the World Series of Fighting, which is like, well, that's bizarre.
What?
Yeah.
And they one fight for the World Series of Fighting? What
exactly.
Was your relationship with the World Series of Fighting? The World Series of Fighting was like a feeder organization at that time.
Something, yeah. I mean,
in a way.
Yeah.
And it was Marlon Moraes, Justin Gaethje, both those guys came from champs over there. UFC.
I think the relationship is very hazy between the old World Series of Fighting and the UFC because there was also people that went the other way, right? Andrei Arlovski gets dropped from the UFC, goes to World Series. Anthony Johnson, boom, all these people.
Yeah.
So they say one fight, World Series of Fighting, we will pay, Zuffa will pay you. But you do one fight.
Okay.
I say, well, that's effed up, but okay. I said, I don't think anyone's going to go for it, but I'll do it. So I leave. And about 6 hours later, I got a phone call and says that deal is no longer available. We are not going to make you an offer. Yeah. So, wow.
And you have no idea why.
Well, I here's my guess. I've never got to sit face to face with Dana and say, what was your problem with me? I think there's four things in my mind. Number one, he didn't really like me. Stemming from the, I called him out on the steroid thing, you know, where he said, it's impossible, and this is where I disagree, it's impossible to test all UFC athletes. And I said, well, that's not true. USADA does it all over the world for all kinds of athletes, right? You can do it. It's just expensive, but let's just call it what it is. You're a private business. You don't have to do drug testing. It's
obviously they do it now. So you
they
were
do
right.
it now. Yeah.
They do it through USADA. So you were totally right.
Yeah. So I was correct. And now, but that was, you know, when Dana is wrong in an argument and he's got this huge army that follows him. And he said, I'd rather watch flies fuck than Ben Askren fight. You know,
I think he said something like, Ambien takes Ben Askren to go to sleep.
Yeah, there's a few of them. So the personal attack started, right? So that's number one. Number two, my fighting style is not highly attractive. But I also think that's a little bit of fake news, because if you look at George St. Pierre's, consistently, now obviously McGregor's trumped him, but only a couple of times. But if you look at consistent basis, George St. Pierre's the number one draw of all time. He heavily relied on takedowns and ground and pound. Yeah. I mean, he didn't have a finish in like 5 years or something.
Well, let me say what my take has always been on you and that style is that it's important and that it really works.
Yeah, like
what you're able to do really works. And I've always said this, and it was proven Saturday night in the Stipe Miocic-Francis Ngannou fight. Wrestling is the most important part of MMA.
Absolutely.
The ability to take the fight to the ground. Obviously, Stipe has a lot of other attributes. He took tremendous punches in that fight. I mean, I know you didn't get a chance to watch it, but
I saw some highlights, though.
Holy shit. I mean, the first round was chaos. I mean, Francis Ngannou is a terrifying guy. And Stipe took the shots, used great movement, used striking of his own, but most importantly, after a while, got his wrestling going. And then once he got Ngannou to the ground, Ngannou didn't have any answers. He didn't know what to do. What you've been able to do to guys like Douglas Lima, who just fought Rory McDonald for the Bellator title.
Really good fight.
Korshkov, who's another fantastic fighter who, you know, has beaten a lot of really top flight guys.
Yeah.
You're able to use your wrestling and completely nullify all their striking and offense.
Yeah.
And that's a huge part of fighting. Fighting is not what's exciting for people to watch. Fighting is what actually works. And what you've been able to do time and time again is take these guys who look like world beaters and completely nullify their offense, take them to the ground, and beat the shit out of them.
Yeah.
That's huge. That's very, very important.
Yeah, absolutely. And so, you know, we can get back to the UFC thing later.
Okay. But so we're back to your situation with the UFC. So the UFC says, we're not interested in you. No offer.
No offer.
So Bellator has released you.
So I had spent 3 months telling Bellator,
do you think
I'm not coming
played
back.
You? Do you feel like the UFC might have
absolutely.
Played you?
Absolutely. They played me hard. So, the reasons. Dana doesn't like me, number one. Number two, my style, not great, right?
Didn't you say something like he's a bald, steroided something or another?
It was mostly after the fact, after that went down that I really tortured him. But, the original one was he's lying about the USADA thing. So that was the simpler. So those people who say me and Dana had beef prior to me not getting an offer.
Have you met him?
Yeah, I mean, yeah.
Not, you talked to him?
We've never had an at-length conversation.
He's a great guy. A lot of people get the wrong impression of him. I mean, I really love the guy.
Yeah, you and I have had different experiences
with
him.
I'm sure
the man,
we have.
So, yeah,
I always feel like I should be there when people have experiences with him. let me let you know the Dana I know.
Yeah, so that would be two. Number three, I think, obviously, stealing a key piece away from Bellator was important to them. And then number four, I think they thought I really had the ability to be their champion. And if someone can be a Bellator champion and make this transition directly to UFC and then be the UFC champion, remember this is when they're going on, Bellator's now on Spike now, that Bellator would use that to say, look, we're the same. He was a champion here, he's a champion there. So I think those four things are, I've never got to sit down face-to-face with Dana and say, why was there no offer? I've never got, like when Anthony Pettis was the champ and, I'm helping coach him or Tyron was, I haven't had more than 5 words with Dana in passing, right? And so it would be really interesting to me to sit down and say, tell me for real, because I have my assumptions on what the deal was, but I don't really know. And then if I have to add number five is I think he got the idea that I would never be a yes man. Which I'm not going to be, never would be. Where Dana really kind of likes the yes man champion. I mean, you see, he's got some heat with Tyron, he's got some heat with Stipe, as we saw on Saturday night, and Dana really struggles with the personalities that won't cater to what he wants to happen.
Well, fighters very rarely are yes men. Then that's by nature of who they are.
A little bit, yeah.
You know, especially the really good ones. Especially as things start going well and start going their way, they realize they're the fucking man. I mean, this is, if you're the guy who's running the division, you're the guy who's running the division.
Yeah.
And you're not going to take any shit from anybody.